Today we'll discuss about the concept of strain. Strain, like stress, is also one of the important concepts in mechanics of materials. Before we get into the discussion of strains, let's talk about motions of bodies. Again, there are two types of bodies. One is rigid body, another one is deformable body. Rigid body by definition is a body in which the distance between any two points will not change after the application of load. Whereas in case of deformable bodies, when a load is applied, the distance between any two points within the body will change. In case of rigid body, there are three types of motions possible. The first one is translation, second one is rotation, and third is a combination of these two, which is more general. In pure translation, we can see the body moves in such a fashion that the orientation of the line with respect to x-axis or y-axis will remain same. So if you see this x-axis, okay, or rather than horizontal line, its orientation is 0 degree with respect to x-axis, and it will remain so throughout the motion. Similarly, the vertical line is making an angle 90 degree with the x-axis. This will also remain same throughout the motion. The body's position may change. It may move from here to here to here, any other position, but the orientation will remain same. That means its position has changed, but the orientation remains same. So this kind of motion we call it as translatory motion. In case of rotary motion, that is pure rotary motion, the orientation will change, whereas the position remains constant. For example, if you look at this point, okay, the x-axis, the horizontal line was here parallel to the x-axis. Now, because of rotation, it is making an angle, some theta, and this theta will continuously change. Please remember, even position also can change. For example, look at this point here. Earlier it was here, now it has to come to this point. So in rotation also, the position will change as well as orientation will change. Only thing, in case of pure rotation, there will be one point whose position is not going to change. Okay, that is pure rotation. More general case would be a combination of translation and rotation. That means both position as well as orientation will change in a more general case. And you won't find any one point like this whose position is fixed, unlike the case of pure rotation. So first one is translation, where orientation remains constant. Second one is pure rotation, where orientation changes, and the third one is general motion, in which both position and orientation can change. So that is about rigid bodies. Now coming back to deformable bodies, by definition, the distance between any two points in the body is changing. So that is a deformable body. Now look at this diagram. This is one such deformation here. The line which was earlier here along x-axis has now moved to this position. Okay, so there has been a rotation also, whereas this is actually called a shear deformation that we'll study later. And there is another one called dilatation. Dilatation is a kind of motion of deformable bodies in which the shape remains same. For example, if you look the dotted lines, these were forming a square. Now after deformation also they remain square, only the size of the square increases. So this kind of change in size is known as dilatation. As you are aware, our discussion will mostly be on the deformable bodies and the kind of deformation that they undergo. Now we'll discuss what is the difference between displacement and deformation. This is a very important distinction one should remember. So now, by definition, what is displacement? Displacement is the absolute movement of a point with respect to a fixed frame of reference or origin. Okay, when a point, say I want to know whether a point has displaced or not, all I have to do is to see whether the point's position has changed with respect to origin or a fixed point or fixed frame of reference. If the position with respect to a fixed frame of reference or origin has changed, then we say body has been displaced. Now, what is deformation in that case? Deformation is also change of position. Only thing is, deformation is a relative movement of a point with respect to another point on the same body. So earlier in displacement, we measured a change of position with respect to a fixed frame of reference, whereas in this case we measure the displacement with respect to another body, another point in the same body. That means if the distance between any two points within the body has changed, then we say the body has deformed. Okay, to summarize, displacement is change of position with respect to a global frame of reference or origin or a point which is outside the body. Okay, that is displacement. If your frame of reference, if your point of interest lies within the body and you are measuring the displacement of that point with respect to another point on the same body, then we call it as deformation. Now look at this case. There is a rigid body. I'm stressing it. This is a rigid body and which has got a dimensions of say 30. Let us say dimension of 30 units. Okay. Now body has been displaced along x-axis by a distance 50. That means point A has moved to this position by 50. So if somebody asks what is the displacement of this point A, will say it is 50 because with respect to origin this point, okay, it has moved 50 units. Now what is the displacement of B? Displacement of B is also 50 because it is a rigid body. Now look at this, from here it has moved to this point, again it is 50 units. So any other point if you take, that will also would have gone undergone same displacement of 50 units because it is a rigid body. So within the body there is no change in the distance. Okay, now the question is what is the deformation displacement of the body A? Yes, displacement of body is 50. What is the displacement of body B? It is also 50. What is the displacement of any other point in the body? That is also 50. But the question is, if somebody asks what is the deformation of the body A, or sorry, deformation of the point A, then the deformation of the point A cannot be measured with respect to origin, but it should be measured with respect to another point. Let us say take a point B. What is the displacement of point A with respect to point B? It is zero, because whatever distance was there, that is 30 units between A and B, also remains same after the movement of the body. So if there is no change between two points, or rather there is no change between the distance between two points on the same body, then we will say there is no deformation. So therefore A and B have both displacement but no deformation. Let us now take the case of a deformable body as shown in the figure below. Now look at this deformable body. The point A and B, earlier distance between them was 30 units. Okay. Now body A has been displaced from here to here. It has come to here to here. Okay. Now what is the distance? It has moved by 40 units. Now I'll say displacement of body A is 40 units. Now let us go to the body point B. Point B has now moved from this point to this point. If you measure the distance, it is 70 units. Okay. So the displacement of the body B is now 70. If you observe, the displacement of body A is 40, whereas the displacement of body is 70. The displacements of the bodies are different now because it's a deformable body. Okay. So what is the displacement of point A? It is 40. What is the displacement of point B? It is 70. Now what is the deformation of point A? Now deformation of point A can only be measured with respect to another point on the same body. Let us take point B. Okay. Now A and B, earlier the distance was 30. Now after the application of load, after the movement of the body, you will find now the distance between A and B has become 60. That means the distance between A and B has changed by 30 units. Therefore, the deformation of A is now 30 units with respect to B. So here we will find body A, point A and point B both have got displacement as well as deformation. So you can as well find out what is the deformation of point B. Deformation of point B can be measured with respect to any other point such as point A. Now distance between B and A was 30 and now it has become 60. The change in the distance between those two bodies is 30 units. Therefore we will say deformation is 30 units. Now this kind of behavior can only be seen in case of deformable bodies. Otherwise, as we saw in the last case here, when for a rigid body, if in any point has got certain displacement, every other point will also have the same displacement. Of course, unless there is no rotation. Now I'll ask you a question. Is 100 rupee a big amount? It depends. If somebody is earning 1000 rupees a month, this 100 rupees becomes a big amount. Obviously, it's the 10% of his monthly income. Now, is this 100 rupees a big amount for somebody who is earning a 1 lakh? Obviously not. That will be a very small fraction of his income. That is less than 1% of his income. Therefore, that will not be a big amount for him. Now, how is it related to bodies? In bodies, a deformation, that is change of distance between two points, is an important concept because this will determine whether the component is going to fail or not. But however, it is not the absolute deformation that is important, that is of importance, rather it's the relative deformation. Okay, now that is what is the change in length divided by original length will give you an idea of how much deformation has occurred with respect to unit original length. That concept is your strain. Strain is it's a relative quantity. It's a ratio between change in length to the original length. Before we get into the details of that, let us first define how many types of strains we normally encounter. We have two types of strains. One is linear strain, which is also known as normal strain. Another one is angular strain. The most popular name, of course, is shear strain. So, if you there are only these two types of strain that you commonly come across your entire course. So, if these two are properly understood, then every concept of MOM with respect to strain is thoroughly understood. Now, let us formally define what is a linear strain or simply a normal strain. Linear strain is defined as a ratio of change in length by original length of a straight line drawn on the deformable. Now, consider an unloaded rod. Okay, there is a rod of circular cross section and which has got a length of initial length of L. Okay, this is initial length of the rod. Okay. This is unloaded means we have not applied any force. Now what happens? Now we'll apply axial load on this. Load P is applied. Now when you apply load, there is a deformation. There is a change in length. The original rod which was of length L now becomes a rod of length L plus delta. What is the change in length? Change in length is delta. As we discussed earlier, deformation is distance between any two points. So, suppose if you consider this as point A, this as point B, the distance between them earlier was L. Now, again the point A is here, the point B is here, the distance between them has now become L plus delta. Delta is your addition or stretching. So, by definition, strain is change in length by original length. Therefore, the strain epsilon is noted given by a notation epsilon is given by change in length delta divided by original length. So, this delta is your change in length or L final minus L initial change in length. And this L, capital L, is your original length. Okay, this is the definition of strain. So, linear strain is change in length by original length and it is given by epsilon is equal to delta by L. There are certain points associated with normal strain. This normal strain is the word normal strain comes into picture because it is associated with normal stress. So, when you apply a normal stress to the body, you will see normal strain being produced. And there are certain terms also, like if the length increases, okay, it's possible that you can decrease the length also. If you are applying tensile load, then length increases. And then the delta resulting change of length, we call it as positive. By convention, we say whenever there is an increase in length of the rod, we will say the delta is positive and corresponding strain is also positive. And the ratio of change in length by original length is known as positive strain, also called as normal tensile strain. If you are applying a compressive load on the rod, you will observe that the length of the rod will decrease. So, this decrease in length delta is known as negative deformation. So, when you take a negative deformation, that is delta divided by the original length, you will get what is known as compressive strain, normal compressive strain, which is negative in value. By convention, we are giving negative to this. So, this is norm compressive strain is given a negative and tensile strain is given a positive sign. Another point is to be remembered is the units of the strain. By definition, strain is ratio of two lengths, change in length by original length. So, for example, if it is measured in millimeter divided by millimeter, these units will cancel. therefore strain is a dimensionless quantity, it has no dimensions. Okay, and then we have a quantity called micro. Micro, you know, as we as already know, it is 10^-6. Usually these strains are very less, that means the deformations are very less, therefore the corresponding strain also is very less. So whenever you come across a quantity called 10^-6, we will replace that by mu, that is micro. So it is common, many times we write strain as micrometer per meter. Okay, of course, as I said, there is no dimension, this meter will get cancels. So this basically means 10^-6, that is one way of writing strain, which are very small. So that was about linear strain. Now let us discuss about shear strain. Shear strain is the most commonly misunderstood concept. Okay, I have seen with my experience, many students fail to understand the concept of shear strain properly. Therefore, let's go in detail and understand what is a shear strain. First, the definition. Shear strain is defined as the change of angle from a right angle. It means I'll take a body as shown here in this diagram, okay, and on the body I'll draw so many lines. Okay, I'm particularly interested in this particular line. Line BC is along x axis and AB is along y axis, and the angle between them is 90 degree. This was the case when I don't apply any load. Now suppose if I apply a load on this body like this, you will see that the AB has rotated like this, has been tilted. Okay, now the angle earlier ABC was 90 degree, now the A has moved to the A dash, now the angle between A1 BC is less than 90 degree. So the 90 degree has reduced to, say, let us say 70 degree. So what is the difference in angle? This is 20 degree. This 20 degree, this gamma is your strain. Of course, you should remember the angle is not measured in degree in SI units, it is measured in radians. Okay, so the decrease in angle, so earlier what was angle in radians? π/2, and it is decreased by gamma. So the decrement, whatever angle is there between A, B and A1, is your shear strain. So if you want to measure the shear strain, all you have to do is you take draw any two perpendicular lines, apply load and see how much is the decrease in this angle, then you will get shear strain. Okay, so therefore the mathematical definition is this notation for shear, of course, is gamma. So this gamma is given by π/2 - α. What is this alpha? This alpha is the angle after the deformation, angle between these two lines after the deformation. So this angle is not our strain, alpha is not our strain, it is 90 - α. So what is the decrease? That decreased angle is your shear strain. So 90 degree, let us say, has become 85 degree. So that 5 degree is your strain. Okay, this 5 degree has to be converted into radian, then whatever answer you get, that will be your shear strain. So to summarize, shear strain is the reduction in angle between two perpendicular lines after the application of load. So whatever angle decreases, that decrease in angle is your shear strain. However, you will see in your textbook another definition of shear strain is also given, which is equivalent actually. If you observe the first figure here, so this body is actually fixed here. Okay, it's fixed here, and then observe again O, let me call this as some point C. Okay, OC is horizontal line, OA is vertical. Earlier body was like this, and I had drawn perpendicular lines AO and OC. The angle between them was 90 degree. Okay. Now when I apply a load or shear stress like this, I'll find body A is now displaced to, sorry, point A is now displaced to point B. Okay. Now earlier the angle between AOC was 90 degree. Because A has moved to B, now the angle between these two lines is BOC. Okay, so this has become alpha. So 90 has become alpha. What is the difference? The difference is this gamma. This is your shear strain. Now usually what happens is, if this AB is very small quantity, and therefore the corresponding gamma, that shear strain, is also small quantity. In such cases, it is possible to write the gamma in some other terms. Now look at this. This gamma is approximately equal to tan gamma that you might have studied from your geometry, or rather from trigonometric relations. So tan gamma is opposite by adjacent. Opposite is AB, adjacent is AO. Therefore tan gamma is given by AB by OA. So therefore gamma or tan gamma or AB by OA, they will all give you same value, which is nothing but shear strain. So when you fix one of the bodies, one of the surfaces like this, and apply a shear strain, the reduction angle gamma is your shear strain. Gamma is almost equal to tan gamma, which is equal to AB by OA. So any of these three definitions can be used to find out the shear strain. In the second diagram, what we have done is we have not fixed one of the surfaces, rather we have kept it free. We have only fixed one point. In such case, I am applying load something like this. I am applying load in this fashion. I am also applying load in this fashion. Okay, you will see, if you observe the angle initially, if you consider this as O, the x2 O and x1 added angle of 90 degree. Okay, now what is happening? This OX2 is moved. The angle has become beta 2. Similarly, the OX1 has moved up by certain angle beta 1. Now what was the definition of shear strain? It is reduction in the 90 degree. So earlier it was 90 degree, now it has become alpha. How much is the reduction? Reduction is, this line has moved by beta 2 and this horizontal line has moved by beta 2. What is the total reduction? Total reduction will be beta 1 plus beta 2. Therefore, the shear strain gamma is now given by beta 1 plus beta 2. Usually, the textbook definition, you will come across only this particular part, the first diagram. But it is to be understood whether the decrease in angle is because of the movement of one surface or two surface, you must take the total decrement in the angle. So 90 degree has become 85 degree. So that resulting 5 degree in measured in radians will be your shear strain. Okay, that's an important perspective to the definition of shear strain. Observe this diagram here on the left hand side. There is a box, a solid material, on which I have placed a rigid rod. Okay, this is the rigid rod, and then this rigid rod I'm applying force. Of course, there is a connection between this and this, that is material and the rigid rod. There is a friction between them, so that whenever you pull, you apply a force like this, this will try to deform the top surface. Okay, now observe the actual loads. Okay, the loads are being applied on this top surface. Okay, on this surface the rigid body will rub the top surface, that means it is applying shear stress in the top surface. But by definition, we are observing the effect of that, that is, we are observing the shear strain in a plane which is perpendicular to this. So if you observe the yellow surface, okay, here we are measuring the shear strain. So the plane on which the shear force is acting and the plane on which we are measuring the shear strain, they are perpendicular. That is, the shear stress plane and shear strain plane, they are perpendicular. Okay, if the this is more clear in the second diagram. Okay, so I'm applying a force, shear force, the body is deformed. Now it has moved by this distance along the x-axis. The original height was this. So from earlier definition, what is strain? So this gamma is given by, that is tan gamma, which is given by, of course, delta x by delta y. So this is the definition of shear strain. So this particular concept must be understood. It's useful for later chapters. In summary, we have discussed what is known as linear strain, what is known as shear strain. Linear strain is change in length between two points divided by the original length, whereas the shear strain, sometimes also called as angular strain, is change in angle between two perpendicular lines. Okay, that's all about shear strain and normal strain.